Thank you very much, dear Chairman, Mr. President. It's a great pleasure again to be here speaking to you, and I really want to thank the organization for this invitation. The topic I have been given is a very wide one nowadays. It used to be something, you know, a curiosity in the books of electrocardiography and cardiology, the long QT syndrome many years ago. But nowadays the thing has become very complex, and for the sake of time, because I have 25 minutes, I'm going to concentrate in only a few channelopathies. So I'm not going to address anything about, channelopathies that might be related also to some structural heart disease. Just take the example of right ventricular dysplasia. And I'm going to limit myself to the sodium and potassium channels, because if we go to the calcium channels, chloride channels, etc., we could be here in 1 year, you know, still discussing about these channelopathies. So what's it all about? What is about channelopathies are diseases of the electrical component of the heart, and they are caused by alterations, by changes in the action potential of the heart that result in a disequilibrium in this action potential. And here you have a very, very, very small summary of the action potential of the heart. Here you have a little bit more complex model of this sodium channel, potassium channels, etc. So you see the structures. And basically what I want to show you with this, structures is that they are these components, the components of these structures are proteins. And the proteins are coming basically from the, are encoded by genes that constitute these channels. That's why we call it channelopathies, when the channels are affected. And these channels, they can be destroyed in many ways. There are several mechanisms why we can get a channelopathy. One of the most common and the most severe is if we have a mutation in the gene that encodes for one of these proteins, for instance, the sodium channel, and this mutation actually truncates the formation of the protein, so you will not have a sodium channel. So in the worst case scenario, you might have an individual that with a channelopathy on the sodium channel that affects 50% of the channels will have only 50% of sodium current for the total cell, which is probably something that you cannot survive. So there is a spectrum in these channelopathies, from very severe forms that may cause simply abortion in utero, so children that will, embryos actually, that will never be able to survive and that we will never see as doctors, to the more light forms, you know, that can be just present as a completely asymptomatic individual. But just remember that all these different channels can be affected, and actually this always is related to modifications of the gene that has to produce, the factory that has to produce the gene. Now, let's start by the sodium channel. You know that the sodium channel is responsible for the phase zero of the action potential. I'm sorry, this pointer is not working. And this is caused by a major entrance of sodium into the cardiac cell that people, this produces this rapid stroke of the action potential that depolarizes the cell and results in current that will go and flow from one cell to the other. Now, the sodium channel is related to three major type of channelopathies. The first one is the long QT syndrome type 3. The second one is Brugada syndrome. And the third one is a conduction disease, which is the so-called Lenegre-Leff syndrome. Now, the interesting thing is that they are all coming from the same problem, from a sodium channel that is sick. But depending upon the location and depending upon the type of change in the protein, in the amino acid that the mutation is causing, you get one disease or another. This is the very first slide that I ever made about Brugada syndrome, long QT syndrome, and conduction disease. And I decided to continue, you know, putting mutations on the slide, and I decided to go back to this first one, because if I would show you now the present situation of mutations in the sodium channel, and you would see only simply dots everywhere on the screen, and you will not be able even to see the sodium channel. So many mutations have been found in the long QT syndrome, also in Brugada syndrome and in conduction disease. But just look here, just a few examples. So in blue, you have conduction disease here. And you see that two mutations next to each other, which are also, you know, mutations changing the amino acid. One results in the long QT syndrome, type 3, and this one results in conduction defect. Look at all the red ones. These all are related to actually the long QT syndrome. And if you look at what we know at that time, which were the first one, causing Brugada syndrome, you have here one, you have there one, and you have another one here. But you will see later on that actually some of these mutations can result in overlap syndromes. They turn out to give you long QT syndrome and Brugada syndrome in the same family, as I showed yesterday or the day before yesterday in my presentation. So you see only mutations in almost in the right part of this channel. This is the open channel. But if you again would see what is the present situation that has become completely crazy, more than 300 mutations only for Brugada syndrome have been described in the sodium channel. Now, what is the result of this long QT syndrome? Basically, every single channelopathy will give you the same problems. Syncope or sudden cardiac death because of ventricular arrhythmias. And in the case of the long QT syndrome, the marker on the electrocardiogram is, of course, a long QT interval. And in this case of the long QT syndrome, we know two different varieties. The one which is inherited as an autosomic dominant trait, which means that 50% of the offspring will be affected. And then we know the one which is a recessive form, and this is the, of course, the recessive form is the more severe form, which is the one associated with deafness also. And because these children inherit two abnormal genes, these are the ones also that we know have the highest mortality in the long QT syndrome. So far, in terms of the long QT syndrome type 3, we only know autosomal dominant forms of this disease, but you know that also the long QT type 3 syndrome is very, very different from the long QT type 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc., all the other ones. And it causes a lot more of sudden cardiac death, and it causes also sudden cardiac death addressed like Brugada syndrome. This is the electrocardiographic feature of the long QT syndrome. There is sinusrhythm. Very frequently, these individuals have sinus bradycardia. You'll find very frequently also that, and I don't know the reason why, but they have a short PR interval, a rather short PR interval. And then this feature of long QT, and in the long QT type 3, usually this tall peaked late T wave with a flat ST segment before that. This is quite typical, is not 100% sensitive, neither 100% specific, but is very suggestive when you see this type of electrocardiogram for a long QT type 3. Here you see an example of how this is inherited in an autonomic dominant manner. So you have in yellow the ones who are alive and have a normal QT. You have some people that died from other causes, but if you look at those who have sudden death in black, or the ones that that have long QT, you see that this not jumping one generation is just affecting all the generations. And in fact, here we had some sudden death that without knowing the value of the long QT, but almost sure that there was some problem starting here that was transmitted to this family down with a 50%. Statistically 50% chance of getting the long QT. So what's happening here? What is the reason for this long QT type 3 caused by mutations in the sodium channel? Well, this is the mirror image of Brugada syndrome, and that's the very interesting thing. So what happens is basically that the QT will prolong because the action potential prolongs, and you see here the result, the late T wave and the prolongation of the QT interval, and that happens because the sodium channel is working too much in this case. It's giving too much current. So if you see here a normal individual, and you see here the current of sodium, at the moment of the phase zero of the action potential, you have, of course, a lot of current, and then the channel closes. You see that this is zero. There is no current after the phase zero of the action potential. A patient that has one of the mutations of causing the long QT type 3, you can see that there is a normal opening of the channel, no problem at all, but then it does not close completely, and there is a leakage of current. Thus, the channel is letting sodium still entering the cell, and as the sodium channel when it lets the sodium ions enter the cell, is a depolarizing current, then you keep on having a depolarization of the cell, and that prolongs the depolarization phase, results in depolarizations, early after depolarizations, typical for the long QT syndrome, and the prolongation of the QT interval. Interesting, if we have now an excess of function of the sodium channel, we might be able to modify that and look at what we have learned in these 20-25 years. That was unthinkable when I was a resident in cardiology, to give a sodium channel blocker, an antiarrhythmic drug, to a patient with a long QT syndrome. The problem is that 20-25 years ago, we had no idea that the long QT syndrome had different diseases in the same box, so that a long QT could be caused, for instance, by a mutation in the sodium channel that was giving an excess of sodium current. So if you put all this, is all the electrocardiogram together of a patient with a long QT type 3, you see this is just to have all the leads together, and we give flecainide, you see how the QT interval shortens, which was inimaginable 25 years ago to do something like this. If I would have done that, I would have been fired as a doctor for the rest of my life. Look at this individual here also, has a clear-cut long QT interval and a very nice example also of a long QT type 3. We give flecainide and the QT interval normalizes. So that's completely different of what we will see later on in Brugada syndrome and the other types of long QT syndrome. Now, I explain you, okay, there are some complex situations indeed, but there are also other diseases, and we are now going to move to Brugada syndrome. Brugada syndrome, you know it very well. We discussed that 2 days ago also widely. It's characterized by this electrocardiogram that shows this ST elevation in the right precordial leads, although I show you also a lot of variants of that. There are conduction defects, P-wave is wide, QRS duration is wide, there is a right bundle branch block in this case, etc., and there are these negative T-waves. Now, the result basically is the same. If you look at the arrhythmias of Brugada syndrome that cause sudden death, they are the same as in the long QT. This is a polymorphic ventricular arrhythmia. You can call it ventricular fibrillation. In the long QT, we call that torsada de Puentes, but basically you have chaos, electrical chaos in the heart, induced either by long QT, by Brugada syndrome, or even the short QT interval, as we will discuss later on. Exactly the same, the type of inheritance in Brugada syndrome is, as far as we know at the present time, autosomic dominant. Here you see a family, an example of a family, with the mother affected, the children that are affected, carrying the mutation through all the different generations without jumping one generation, like it is typical for recessive forms of inherited arrhythmia disorders. What is the problem here? Well, again, this is the sodium channel, but the problem is that the sodium channel inactivates faster, so stops producing current too fast. It's just simply not allowing to have sufficient sodium current because the sodium channel inactivates much too fast. And there are no persistent sodium currents like in the long QT syndrome. And you see here very nicely the difference between patients with Brugada syndrome and the long QT type 3 syndrome. We will start by looking here at the wild type. You see here this is the normal sodium current. And if you compare this with a mutated sodium channel, in some cases, you don't see much difference because in Brugada syndrome, this phenomenon is temperature dependent in some mutations. And here you can see that if you now increase the temperature of your preparation to 32 degrees, you will see that what happens is this is the wild type, this is the normal sodium channel, a person without mutation, and this is the person with the mutation, and you see that it closes too fast. And by closing too fast, the sodium current is reduced. It's just the contrary of the long QT type 3. And of course, anything that we will do in the long QT 3, which is good, is bad for Brugada syndrome, because this is the mirror image of the disease. What is the mechanism of the ST segment elevation? There are many theories at the present time, but basically the two important theories is the one that says, you know, because of the delayed or because of the lack of a sufficient sodium current, there is slow conduction between cardiac cells, and this creates a gradient, a voltage gradient, that will result in the ST segment elevation. And the other theory says, no, the problem is because of the reduced sodium channel current, you have a dominance of the transient outward potassium current that will repolarize very rapidly the cell, and the gradient is also present, but is not because of a slow conduction, is because of very fast repolarization of the cell. Now, here, what from the clinical point of view is very important is that fever in Brugada syndrome can alter the function of the sodium channel. And you see here a child with a typical pattern of Brugada syndrome when he had fever, and without the pattern, actually, if the fever disappears. Among other things, the consequence of this is that children can develop ventricular arrhythmias during fever, and you should be aware of that when you have diagnosed Brugada syndrome, that fever in a pediatric population is a very important prognostic factor because of course, of the arrhythmias that they can cause. I show you already that in this case, if you give now a sodium channel blocker, what you are going to do is the contrary of what you did in the long QT type 3, because it's the mirror image. So in this case, you see there's the Ashmolin test, and of course with Ashmolin, you actually will develop, or you will unmask Brugada syndrome in this case, and even you can develop ventricular arrhythmias instead of improving Brugada syndrome. Sodium channel blockers actually worsen Brugada syndrome. And that's the reason for that. These are two diseases of the sodium channel, but the long QT syndrome is caused by prolongation of the action potential duration. And in Brugada syndrome, the problem is shortening of the action potential or delayed activation, doesn't matter. But the way the voltage gradient is created is different. The reason is different. Here you have an excess of sodium current. Here you have too less sodium current. And that's the reason that sodium channel blockers can cure patients with long QT syndrome, but can kill patients with Brugada syndrome. So you see it here, an example. Again, this we another example of the long QT type 3, normalizing after flecainide, and a patient with Brugada syndrome worsening after, in this case, not Ashmolin, but flecainide administration. Thus, as I told you, indeed, be careful with these drugs because the ventricular fibrillation can occur during the administration of these drugs, also when you are doing the test to unmask Brugada syndrome. Let's move for 1 second to the third disease that is related to the sodium channel. This Lenegre disease, of Lenegre left disease, is a conduction defect linked to the sodium channel. And I show you already in blue a couple of mutations that are known to cause familial conduction disease, individuals that go into AV block and require implantation of a pacemaker. What is the problem here? Here there is a major reduction of the sodium current, and that results in, of course, slow conduction, widening of the QRS complex, and also repolarization abnormalities. And if you actually look at what happens in this disease, we will come to that at the end of the presentation. In fact, this is akin to Brugada syndrome, and as I said, we see more and more overlap families with overlap syndromes, where females with the same mutation as males present with conduction disease, and males present with Brugada syndrome. Let's move to the potassium channel. The potassium channel has been related to three abnormalities: inherited arrhythmia disorders, long QT syndrome, that was the first one also that was ever recognized as being caused by a mutation, and a mutation in that case in the potassium channel, the short QT syndrome, and familial atrial fibrillation. So the potassium channels are very complex because they are made of actually different components. And I'm going to not to enter this, but just keep in mind that the same that I show you for the sodium channel is true for this. These are all mutations linked to the long QT syndrome. At the time that the slide was made, if I would make again the slide, the whole slide would be yellow. You would not see anything because of the numerous mutations that have been described. I also show you here only six forms of the long QT syndrome. There are at the present time 18 different genes linked and combination of genes linked to the potassium channel. But it's basically to show you that actually these are completely different diseases. They have nothing to do with each other. A long QT type 3 related to the sodium channel has nothing to do with the long QT type 1 that is related to the KVLQT1 gene. You know, this has nothing to do at all. They are completely different diseases. But the manifestations on the electrocardiogram remain the same, a long QT interval. The cause, again, in this case, you get a long QT interval, but now this is because of the potassium channel that is working wrong. So you know that the potassium channel tries to repolarize the cell, while the calcium channel tries to maintain the phase two of the action potential, depolarize. Now, if the potassium channel turns out not to work properly, in this case, too less, thus there is not enough potassium current, then the repolarization is delayed, and you get a long QT interval, and that's the cause of the long QT type 1, type 2, etc., not the long QT type 3. So you can see it here, basically. This is simply the potassium current in a normal individual, and here you see the potassium current in a mutated channel, and you can see here that there is no current at all. At the moment that this current should be activated, nothing happens. So it's not working at all. The correlations between this long QT and syndromes and the genetic defect have been made. And as I said to you, this is an approximative way of looking at the electrocardiogram. This is not 100% sensitive, neither specific. But it has been suggested that in long QT type 1, the one that is caused by mutations in the sodium channel, most individuals show this flat ST and a late peak T wave. In type 2, you have this type of electrocardiogram, a broad, it's a long QT, but a broad T wave that starts early and is very broad. And in type 3, you have here this late and very flat and low voltage T wave. This is good to have an first idea of maybe what you are seeing, but of course the real diagnosis has to be a molecular genetic diagnosis. In any case, what is true is that all these diseases bring exactly the same result into the heart as a and the one which is the consequence of sudden death, which is, again, electrical chaos, ventricular fibrillation, polymorphic VT, torsada de pontes. Doesn't matter what the name that you give to this arrhythmia, but this is total chaos in the heart. Now, the short QT syndrome, this is the latest one that has been described. We published that in 2000, and actually only a few years later, 3 years later, we had already found the genetic defect of this disease, which is seems not to be found very commonly. I mean, there are not many families that have been seen, and typically this disease is characterized by a short QT interval, and with this symmetrical peaked T wave. And what is the problem here? Well, if this is a short QT instead of a long QT, that has to be the mirror image of the long QT syndrome. And effectively, it is like that. It is also an autosomic dominant form of disease. There's, as you can see here, again, an example of this peaked tall T wave with a short QT interval. And here what is happening is the contrary. There is too much potassium current. And this is seen here. This is the normal situation. And you see here that when you actually have the mutation, in this case, then you'll see that for the different depolarizations that you provoke, you will increase the potassium current. And this potassium current, of course, will repolarize the cell. And by repolarizing the cell very fast, because of a lot of potassium current, you will shorten the action potential, and actually you will get this shorter QT interval and this peak T wave. This, in some way, this looks more like Brugada syndrome caused by potassium mutation than anything else. So you see the complexity of all these diseases, but still the same problem is coming. And if anything that alters this very subtle equilibrium of the action potential, then will result in disease. Let's move to the atrial fibrillation story. Is that also channelopathy? Of course it is. We know that in Brugada syndrome, there are a lot of patients, about 20-25%, that will develop atrial fibrillation with a completely normal heart. But also, we know that there are familial forms of atrial fibrillation with a completely normal electrocardiogram. Again, you see here patterns of inheritance in these families is autosomic dominant, and when you look at this atrial fibrillation, that's not the atrial fibrillation that we see in everyday cardiology. These are very young individuals, mean age 18 years, with a range up to 35. They have a normal echocardiogram. The majority of them have chronic atrial fibrillation, and they are asymptomatic, as you can see, 36 of 42, and even when they have heart rates, which are absolutely not normal. And of course, these patients, if you just follow them up, can go later on into tachycardiomyopathies and may develop also very early in life problems of embolization. You see what here is happening. Here, there is a gain of function in the potassium channel. So this is a sort of short QT in the atrium. Yeah? So the atrium now is affected by this atrial fibrillation because of a gain of function of the potassium channel, the same of the short QT. And then you will not be surprised that once you have seen this, that there are no surprises that the short QT syndrome is also associated to a high incidence of atrial fibrillation, like Brugada syndrome is associated to atrial fibrillation, and that these diseases can appear very early in life. And for instance, there is a case report of an individual with short QT syndrome with atrial fibrillation diagnosed in utero. Of course, if that had been, instead of atrial fibrillation, ventricular fibrillation, that person would have never been come to our world and would have never made the diagnosis of Brugada syndrome. Again, here, look at the final result of everything, whether it is long QT, whether it is Brugada syndrome, whether this is short QT syndrome, you always come to the same, and is chaos in the heart. I said I'm not going to be able to show you anything about other diseases that are a mix up of channelopathies and structural heart disease, but I would like you to show you these slides dealing with the present research, in this case in Brugada syndrome, in the sense of, you know, the genetically, the transgenic mouse with Brugada syndrome. Look at what a beautiful thing. He's not bald. That's the only difference with the family Brugada, but well. So, but you see here, that's the normal mouse, and here you see one with a mutation, and you see the reduced sodium current. That's what you see. Secondly, if you look at the electrocardiogram, of course, the electrocardiogram of these individuals, you have to be aware they have a heart rate of 400 beats per minute. So that's different from, so this is, you see, this is 25 milliseconds only, this line. And you see here, during a stimulation, you see simply this, actually this is the His bundle recording, and you see that the widening of the QRS complex in the mutated mice, and you can see also the ST segment elevation. So it's simulating all the features of Brugada syndrome. But now the most important thing, look at this. These individuals, you see here nicely, this is before, this is the normal mice, and this is the mutated one. You see the conduction disturbances, and you see the widening of the QRS complex, etc. But if you now follow these mice, and you examine them after 6 months, which is a long period, is equivalent, they say, to about 60 years for a human being, actually you'll see that these individuals with the mutation develop fibrosis. And this was the first time that a link was made between a channelopathy and structural heart disease. And the hypothesis is that once you have a channelopathy and that heart is not working properly, then at that time fibrosis might come into place, and that might explain some of the overlapping syndromes and sometimes the difficulties that we have between distinguishing some forms of right ventricular dysplasia and, for instance, Brugada syndrome. And finally, I just wanted to show you that there is a lot of hope for the future, because progress has been enormous. Look at this. This is a graph showing you here, these are the years. This is the year where the disease was described, You can see here, for instance, Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, described in 1930. It took about 70 years to get the first gene of familial Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. And you see here, long QT syndrome already was 40 years that it took, sorry, 30 years to discover the gene. Catecholamine-induced ventricular tachycardia was discovered in 78. It took about 20 years to discover the gene. For Brugada syndrome, it took only 6 years to discover the first gene. And for the long QT syndrome, 3 years. And you see that, I think that maybe at the, in the future, we will be looking at something different. That is that we will be looking in the genetics laboratory to diseases that might have to be found in the clinic. This is what I call reverse genetics. You can speculate on anything in the action potential and say there must be a disease that produces whatever you want, and then we will have to search for this disease. You can predict it from the genetic point of view, cellular electrophysiology point of view, and thus, as clinicians, we'll have to search for the disease. Thus, for the attendees, for the residents, for the people that is training now, don't worry, there is still a lot of research to be done in the future, and you have a real, very bright future in electrophysiology. Thank you very much for your attention.